mentioned last night in our discussion about al-Jannah, the paradise of Allah Azza wa Jal, that paradise is a place of pure delight and joy, but without the vexations and problems of the dunya. And we divided the pleasures of al-Jannah into two parts. The first type, we said, are the sensual, materialistic pleasures. And the second, the spiritual. And we began discussing the materialistic pleasures of Jannah, as Allah tells us in the Quran and the traditions of Ahlul Bayt alayhim as-salam tell us. We said the general law, according to the Quran, about al-Jannah was that فيها ما تشتهيه الأنفس وتلذ الأعين. Everything that you want, everything that you crave, everything that your heart desires, you will find in Jannah. Anything you think about, and even beyond your imagination. We said the hadith of the Holy Prophet says about the Jannah, فيه ما لا عين رأت ولا أذن سمعت ولا خطر على قلب بشر. It is even beyond our imagination. And the second verse that we spoke about was the verse where Allah says, لَهُمْ دَارُ السَّلَامِ عِنْدَ رَبِّهِمْ. Allah calls heaven دَارُ السَّلَامِ. It is the place of absolute peace. There are absolutely no problems, no tensions, no stress, no discomfort, no violence, no crimes, no diseases, no sicknesses in al-Jannah. And thus it is labeled as Dar al-Salam, the place of complete peace and absolute comfort. The verses of the Holy Quran and the traditions of Ahlul Bayt, likewise, they tell us about the physical descriptions of Jannah, meaning the landscape of Jannah, the vegetation of Jannah. The natural scenery is likewise mentioned in the Ahadith and the Quran. And the point that we see is reiterated and repeated many times in the Quran when Allah speaks about al-Jannah, He describes it with this statement, جَنَّاتٌ تَجْرِي مِن تَحْتِهَا الْأَنْهَارِ. When you ask what is heaven, the Quran says it is Jannat. Jannat means gardens. Jannah means a garden. It is gardens, huge gardens, and beneath the gardens, rivers flow. So one of the beautiful aspects of Jannah is the gardens, the trees, and the rivers. Obviously, when you envision paradise, when you think about Jannah, obviously you're gonna think about the greenery and the water. There has to be the greenery, the plants, the trees, and the gardens, and there has to be water. There has to be rivers, oceans, lakes, and so on and so forth. And thus Allah tells us about the Jannah, جَنَّاتٌ تَجْرِي مِن تَحْتِهَا الْأَنْهَارِ. Gardens, and beneath the gardens, there are rivers. And when we come to the trees of Al-Jannah, the trees of Al-Jannah are very different from the trees of the dunya. How so? When we read about the trees of the Jannah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He speaks about them in the Quran. In one verse, for example, He says, وَفَاكِهَةٍ كَثِيرًا. The trees of Jannah will have fruits, of course, many fruits. The Quran says kathira, filled with fruits. So they will look more beautiful, the trees with the fruits. And then the Quran says, la maqtu'atin wala mamnu'a. You will not be denied from the trees, from the fruits of Jannah. Nor will they ever diminish. Now what does this mean? The Ahadith tell us four unique things about the trees and fruits of Jannah. Four beautiful things. Number one, the Hadith tells us that the fruits of Al-Jannah are not seasonal. The fruits of this earth are seasonal. There are certain fruits you will only find in the summer. Other fruits you will only find in the winter. They are seasonal. You won't find them throughout the year. The fruits of Al-Jannah are not seasonal. They are available at all times. Thus the Quran says, لا مقطوعة ولا ممنوعة. It's available all the time. That's number one. Number two, another fascinating thing the Hadith tells us about Al-Jannah is that in the dunya, one individual tree can only give you one type of fruit. Correct? You have an apple tree. Can an apple tree give you oranges? No. Can an orange tree give you bananas? No, of course not. One tree can give you only one type of fruit at a time. If you want another fruit, you have to plant another tree. The hadith of the Imam says, what's beautiful about the trees and fruits of Al-Jannah is one tree can contain up to 100 types of fruits. You look at the tree, you want to see what type of tree it is. But you find oranges in it, and apples, and bananas, and mangoes, and pears, and peaches, and strawberries, and raspberries, and blueberries, and redberries, and whatever type of fruits you can think of. Just look at these, the decorations here, the different colors. This is how the trees of Jannah will be. And this is what will add to the pleasure and the beauty of Jannah. One tree, it has more than one type of fruit. That's number two. And number three, the ahadith tell us about the fruits of Al-Jannah is that when you go to pick the fruit, as soon as you pick the fruit from the tree, Allah will place another fruit right back at its place. So there will never be an empty place for the fruit. It will always be full, the trees. You take a fruit, Allah will add a fruit. You take another fruit, Allah will add it. It will always look full. This is from the beauty of the trees of Al-Jannah. So these are some beautiful facts about the trees of Jannah. In another verse, Allah Azza wa Jal tells us, وَذُلِّلَتْ قُطُوفُهَا تَذْلِيلًا. Allah tells us that what's beautiful about Jannah is that if you want to pick a fruit, you don't have to go to the fruit. In the dunya, if you see a beautiful tree that has fruits, if you want to pick the fruit, you have to go to the fruit. Sometimes you will need to place a ladder. You have to go up on the ladder and then you can pick up the fruit because it's high. With the trees of Jannah, they are easily accessible. You don't have to go to it. The hadith says you can be sitting on your couch. You extend your hand. The branches of the trees will be very low. You just pick the fruit while you're sitting and you eat it. And one other beautiful tafsir tells you that you can be sitting on the couch and you see a tree. It's beautiful, it's far. You extend your hand and you see that the fruit comes to you. So, ذُلِّلَتْ قُطُوفُهَا تَذْلِيلًا. That means whenever you want, you desire the fruit, the branch will come down in a way in which you just extend your hand, you take the fruit and you eat it. This is amongst the beauties of Al-Jannah. And you see how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He tells us, قطوفها, that you can pick the fruit. If you have the option to pick a fruit directly from the tree, it's always much nicer than buying it from the store. Why? First of all, because you picked it and there's something special about it when you pick it. That's why if you go to someone's house and he brings you a bowl of fruit, if you think it's from Walmart or Sobeys, you're not going to eat it. But if he tells you, I picked this fruit, I hand-picked them from my backyard, now you will eat it. Why? Not only has he handpicked it, so there's something special about it, but also you know it's fresh. You know that it's from today. You know it's not old. So this adds to the beauty of the fruits of Al-Jannah. So this is some facts about the trees of Al-Jannah. But then there is one tree in Al-Jannah which is very, very unique. Yes, all of the trees of Jannah are unique and beautiful. But there is one tree that stands out. And once you go, inshallah, to Jannah, you will not miss this tree. This tree is called Shajarat Tuba. Allah Azza wa Jal says in the Quran, الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ طُوبَى لَهُمْ. Those individuals that had iman, faith, and they did good deeds. عَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ. What will Allah give them? This verse says, طُوبَى لَهُمْ. Allah Azza wa Jal will give them tuba. Tuba is a tree, shajaratu tuba. And it's a very, very special tree. Why is it so special? It is one of the main landmarks of Jannah. One of the most notable and important landmarks of Jannah is tuba. You will not miss tuba. Why? Because of its huge size. It is the largest tree in Jannah according to the ahadith. It's so large that you can see it even outside of Jannah. Before you enter Jannah, you're standing by the gates, you could see شجرة طوبة. It is so large, the hadith says, if a bird, let's say an eagle, wants to fly to the top, to reach the top of the tree, the bird would die before it could reach the top because its lifespan is not enough. So it's humongous, it's beyond our imagination. Another aspect of this tree, which makes it special, is that this tree doesn't only contain fruits. The hadith says it also contains gold and silver. You can see just gold and silver coming down from the tree of Tuba. You can see the hadith says gems and pearls and rubies and emeralds and crystals hanging down from this tree. Another aspect that adds to the beauty of this tree is the location of the tree. Where does it stem out of? The hadith tells us it stems out of the house of Ali ibn Abi Talib alayhi salam. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad wa ajjal farajahum. The tree of Tuba, if you want to see where is this huge tree stemming out of, you will be led to the house of Ali ibn Abi Talib and the house of Rasulullah because they are neighbors in Al-Jannah. And the hadith says that there is a branch stemming from this tree in the house of every mu'min. Every mu'min, he will have a branch stemming into his house from the tree of Tuba. And our ahadith indicate that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam, when he went to Al-Mi'raj, when Allah took him to the Jannah with Jibra'il, when he came back, he told his ashab about the tree of Tuba because it is something to see. You won't miss it. It's something amazing. He said, he told his ashab that I saw the tree of Tuba when I went to Al-Jannah. And this tree of Tuba has a very special relationship and connection to one of Ahlul Bayt alayhim as-salam's members. One of the members of Ahlul Bayt has a special connection with the tree of Tuba. Who is it? Fatima al-Zahra alayha as-salam. Our ahadith indicate that Fatima alayha as-salam has a special ilaqa, has a special relationship or connection with the tree of Tuba that I'm speaking about. And I'll read you two ahadiths. In one hadith, it's narrated that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam, he used to highly respect Fatima. He used to always stand up for her. He used to hug her, kiss her, spoil her, highly respect her. Aisha, the wife of Rasulullah, she was annoyed, bothered by that. Rasulullah gives Fatima more attention, and she's young, a child, than he gives Aisha. So she was bothered by this. Rasulullah, he noticed that Aisha is bothered by how he is treating Fatima, his daughter. He came to Aisha one day. He told her, Ya Aisha, I know that you're bothered because of how I respect Fatima, because of how I hug her and I kiss her all the time. But let me tell you the story. When I went in the Mi'raj, when I went into the heavens of Allah, Jibra'il took me to the tree of Tuba. He told me, this is the famous tree of Tuba that you heard about so much, that we read in the Quran about. And then Jibra'il brought me a fruit from the tree of Tuba. He gave it to me. I ate that fruit. And then he says, when I went back to the dunya, I went to Khadija and Fatima was conceived that same night from the fruit of Shajar al-Tuba. So Fatima alayha salam, her source is al-Jannah. And that's why we call her what? Insiyatun Huriya. She is half human, half Hawra. Huriya, Hur al-Ain. Because her origin and source was from Al-Jannah. It was only after Rasulullah ate from the fruits of Al-Jannah, Tuba, that she was conceived. So her source is from Al-Jannah. And then he told Aisha, Ya Aisha, every time I smell the scent of Fatima, I remember Al-Jannah. When we, inshallah, enter heaven, heaven has the most beautiful scent, fragrance, and perfume that you can imagine. It will blow you away. It is out of the world. The Holy Prophet says that scent, that beautiful fragrance, I see it in Fatima. Every time I go close to her, I see she has the smell of Jannah, the fragrance of Al-Jannah. Don't blame me if you see I'm always around Fatima because she reminds me of Al-Jannah, subhanAllah. In another hadith, it's narrated that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was sitting in his house one day. All of a sudden, Ayman, his wife, comes to the house. She comes inside the house and she has a bag with her filled with stuff. Rasulullah asks Ayman, his wife, "What's in your bag? What did you bring?" She told him, "I went to a wedding and I brought some nathar from the wedding." What is nathar? In the weddings back then, it was a custom until now some weddings. After the wedding finishes, they bring some sweets or some items, and then they throw it. They disperse it on the attendees, on the invitees. You take some, you bring it back home. So I went to the wedding and I brought some of the nathar of that wedding. And then the hadith says, Ayman began to cry. Rasulullah told her, "Ya Ayman, why are you crying? What happened?" She told Rasulullah, "Ya Rasulullah, because I remembered the wedding of Fatima alayhi salam. I remembered that in the wedding of Fatima there was no nathar. Nobody came to distribute any sweets. Nobody came to throw, to give as a sign of celebration, to give the people that were there some sweets, some gifts. So when I remembered how this lavish wedding has this nathar, and the wedding of Fatima didn't have that, and how she was an orphan, her mother was not there, I could not help but cry." Ayman is crying for Fatima alayhi salam because there was no nathar in her wedding. Look at the answer of Rasulullah. Rasulullah told her, "Ya Ayman, do not cry. فَوَالَّذِي بَعَثَنِي بِالْحَقِّ بَشِيرًا وَنَذِيرًا." He told her, "Ya Ayman, wallahi, I swear to you that when Fatima got married in the dunya, don't look at that simple, humble, modest wedding that she had in the dunya. Because Allah Azza wa Jal at the same time, He held a corresponding wedding in Al-Jannah." Do you know when Fatima got married, Allah Azza wa Jal, He held a festive, a celebration in Al-Jannah, in paradise, for Fatima. He told her, "Do you know who the attendees were? Jibra'il, Mika'il, Israfil, and thousands of angels. They were rejoicing for the marriage, for the wedding of Fatima alayha salam." And then, and this is the last part of the hadith that I want to mention, the Holy Prophet told Ayman, Allah then ordered Shajarat Tuba, the tree of Tuba, he ordered it to shake. He told Tuba, "Shake, so that some of your goods, your fruits, your gold, your silver, your gems, they are scattered on the angels as a nithar." And then the Prophet says it began to rain gold and silver and crystals in the wedding of Fatima in Al-Jannah. So do not feel upset. Maybe we did not give out some sweets. We didn't disperse some sweets in the wedding of Fatima in the dunya. But in the akhirah, it was raining gold and silver for the wedding of Fatima alayhi salam. And then the Prophet said, Allah Azza wa Jal then, He gifted the tree of Tuba to Fatima. He told her, "Ya Fatima, this huge tree of Tuba that we will all see on a daily basis. You go out of your house, you see it because it's so huge. It's like the sun, it's like the moon. This huge tree is a gift to you. It is the dowry of your marriage." Subhanallah. It belongs to Fatima. It stems out of the house of Ali ibn Abi Talib. And everything in Jannah reminds you of Ahlul Bayt, my friends. Because Allah wants everybody to constantly remember that Ahlul Bayt own Al-Jannah. Everything in Al-Jannah belongs to them. So this is Shajarat Tuba. These ahadith and verses are the trees and the gardens of Al-Jannah. Salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. The ahadith also tell us, and the verses of the Quran, they tell us about the fountains and springs of Al-Jannah, Uyun Al-Jannah. Yesterday, we spoke about two of the famous springs in Al-Jannah. There are many springs, but there are a few springs and fountains that are very famous. They're important. We said when we enter Jannah, the Prophet says, we will be taken to a spring and we will be given a drink from that spring, where Allah says, وَسَقَاهُمْ رَبُّهُمْ شَرَابًا طَهُورًا. We will be given a drink and it will cleanse and purify our nafs and our bodies from all impurities. And then we are taken to another spring, And we are told to submerge, to swim, take a shower in that second spring, and we will become immortal. We will live forever. We mentioned this yesterday. So these are two springs of Al-Jannah. There are some other notable and famous springs of Al-Jannah. Amongst them is a spring called Salsabil. It's mentioned in the Quran. Allah says in the Holy Quran, عَيْنًا فِيهَا تُسَمَّى سَلْسَبِيلًا. He says one of the uyun, one of the springs and fountains of Jannah is called, what? It's called Salsabil. The name of it is Salsabil. And we also read and hear about Salsabil in the month of Ramadan. When we read Dua al-Iftitah, when we finish Dua al-Iftitah, there are a few short du'as after that. One of the du'as also tell us about Salsabil. Allahumma birahmatika fis salihina fa'adkhilna wa fi 'illiyina farfa'na. Ya Allah, we ask you to take us to heaven and in the highest levels of heaven. And then what do we say? Wa bika'sin min ma'inin min 'aynin salsabilin. And we ask you, Ya Allah, we recite this every night in Ramadan. Ya Allah, take us to heaven, the highest levels of heaven, and give us a drink, a pure drink from the spring of Salsabil. But the question is, who will give us the drink of Salsabil? Who will have the honor to feed all the mu'mineen, the mu'minat, from that pure, beautiful spring of Salsabil? It is none other than Ali ibn Abi Talib once again. No matter what topic I speak to you about in Jannah, I will go back to Ali and Fatima. Because Ali and Fatima own al-Jannah. Salla ala Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad. Everything in al-Jannah belongs to them. You go to the Ayn of Salsabil, you see Ali ibn Abi Talib is there. You want a drink? You have to ask Ali. Ali gives you the drink. Where do we read this? In one of the ziyarat of Ali ibn Abi Talib. May Allah Azza wa Jal grant all of you the honor to go to Najaf and do ziyarah of Imam Ali alayhi salam. And may Allah grant us all the shafa'a of Imam Ali in the akhirah, inshallah. In one of the ziyarat of Imam Ali alayhi salam, what do we read? As-salamu ala mizan al-a'mal wa muqallib al-ahwal wa sayfi dhil-jalal. We say, peace be upon you, Ya Ali. Who is Ali? There's so much titles. We say, peace be upon you, Ali. You are the scale of good and evil. He is Qasimul Jannati wal Nar. Muqallib al Ahwal. He's the one that made the difference in all of the battles. Wa Sayfi dhil Jalal. You are the sword of Allah. Unfortunately, this title has now been given to someone else. They say Khalid ibn al-Walid. Correct? He is Saifullah al-Maslul. But he's not. The true unleashed sword of Allah Azza wa Jal is Ali ibn Abi Talib. It's not Khalid. It's Ali ibn Abi Talib. Wa Saifi dhil Jalal. He is the sword of Allah Azza wa Jal. So we read, As-salamu ala mizan al-a'mal wa muqallib al-ahwal wa Saifi dhil Jalal wa saqi al-salsabil al-zulal. Peace be upon you, Ya Ali. You are the one that will give us a drink from the pure, Zulal means pure, the pure drink of Salsabil. It is Ali ibn Abi Talib. And the ahadith tell us that he's the first one that will drink from that spring on the day of judgment in Al-Jannah, and he will feed all the mu'mineen, mu'minat in Al-Jannah. So this is one of the springs of Jannah, Salsabil. Another spring that Allah tells us about in Jannah is the spring of Tasneem. The spring of Tasneem. The Quran says about Tasneem, وَمِزَاجُهُ مِن تَسْنِيم. Allah will give us a beautiful, delicious drink on the Day of Judgment. But this drink will be mixed with Tasneem. It will be mixed. So it's not purely Tasneem, but it will be mixed with Tasneem. What is Tasneem? Continue the verse. وَمِزَاجُهُ مِن تَسْنِيم. You ask, what is Tasneem? عَيْنًا يَشْرَبُ بِهَا الْمُقَرَّبُونَ. It is a ayn, it is a spring that the muqarrabun, the close ones will drink from. The hadith of Imam al-Sadiq alayhi salam says that tasneem ashrafu sharab ahlil jannah. It is the most noble, it is the greatest drink that we will have on the day of judgment in al-Jannah. It is called tasneem, but then he says only the muqarrabin, they will drink pure tasneem. The cup will be filled with pure tasneem. And the muqarrabin are Muhammad and Al Muhammad. Salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. The muqarrabun, they will have pure tasneem. But the other believers, like you inshaAllah, you will have a mix, some of tasneem. The Quran said, وَمِزَاجُهُ مِنْ tasneem. So you will have a drink, and to the drink will be added tasneem. So you won't have it purely, because it is only for Ahlul Bayt. عَيْنًا يَشْرَبُ بِهَا الْمُقَرَّبُونَ. It is only the muqarrabin. And the ahadith tell us that حوض الكوثر, the great pond or pool of Kawthar that we will drink from before we go to heaven, one of the sources of Kawthar is tasneem. Kawthar, the pool of Kawthar, has a few sources, water sources. One of them is tasneem. It pours into this river and we drink into this pool and we drink and then we enter heaven. So this is the second spring or fountain in Al-Jannah. The third spring that we read about in the Quran, Allah doesn't tell us the name, but He speaks about it. Allah says, إِنَّ الْأَبْرَارَ يَشْرَبُونَ مِنْ كَأْسٍ كَانَ مِزَاجُهَا كَافُورًا. That you will be also given another drink. And this drink will be mixed with kafur. You know kafur, the special plant. It will be mixed with kafur. Now, what is this drink? Where does it come from? Allah also continues. He says, عَيْنًا يَشْرَبُ بِهَا عِبَادُ اللَّهِ يُفَجِّرُونَهَا تَفْجِيرًا. Allah Azza wa Jal says that this is also a fountain, a spring. But this verse, Allah says, عِبَادُ اللَّهِ will drink from it. So this apparently it seems that we can drink purely, even though it will be mixed with kafur, but we can have a pure drink because عِبَادُ اللَّهِ will drink. As for tasneem, it is for the muqarrabeen. And the hadith of the holy Imam says that this spring is in the house of Rasulullah and it will flow into the houses of other believers. So this is when it comes to the springs of Jannah and the fountains of Jannah. And then we move on to the rivers of Jannah. Obviously, we said any beautiful place has to have rivers or oceans. And Allah constantly mentions in the Quran when He describes Jannah, He says, جَنَّاتٌ تَجْرِي مِنْ تَحْتِهَا الْأَنْهَارِ. Gardens, and beneath the gardens there are rivers. What are the rivers of Jannah? I will read you. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in one verse, He tells us about the rivers of Jannah. Listen to this verse. He says, مَثَلُ الْجَنَّةِ الَّتِي وُعِدَ الْمُتَّقُونَ. Allah says that the Jannah, the paradise that I have promised, the muttaqeen, the pious, the righteous. What does it have? Allah says, فِيهَا أَنْهَارٌ مِنْ مَاءٍ غَيْرِ آسٍ. Amongst the rivers of Jannah are rivers that have pure water. This is one type. فِيهَا أَنْهَارٌ مِنْ مَاءٍ غَيْرِ آسٍ وَأَنْهَارٌ مِنْ لَبَنٍ لَمْ يَتَغَيَّرْ طَعْمُهُ. A second type of rivers are the rivers that you will see in Jannah, rivers filled with milk, white milk. And the Quran says, لَمْ يَتَغَيَّرْ طَعْمُهُ. That milk will never spoil. It will never go rancid because milk, as you know, it has an expiration date. The milk of Al-Jannah, which flows in rivers, will never go rancid. It is always fresh and delicious. This is a second type of river in Al-Jannah. And then the Quran says, وَأَنْهَارٌ مِنْ خَمْرٍ. There are rivers of wine. لَذَّةٍ لِلشَّارِبِينَ. It is so, tastes so good, tastes so delicious, so beautiful. Now, the rivers of wine, you may ask, how is there wine in Jannah? The Quran tells us that the wine of Jannah, of course, it'll be millions of times better than the wine of dunya. But however, it is not intoxicating. So you don't become drunk when you drink from the wine of Al-Jannah. Where does Allah say this? In another verse, Allah says, after He speaks about the rivers of Jannah and the drinks of Al-Jannah, He says, لَا فِيهَا غَوْلٌ وَلَا هُمْ عَنْهَا يُنزَفُونَ. When you drink from Al-Jannah, from the wine of Al-Jannah, you will not become intoxicated. وَلَا هُمْ عَنْهَا يُنزَفُونَ. That means it will not affect your judgment nor your mind. I saw a hadith from one of the Imams that says, if anyone tastes the wine of the dunya, then he will never taste the wine of the Jannah. Allah Azza wa Jal has reserved those rivers of wine in Al-Jannah for whoever didn't drink from the wine of the dunya. You can't have it both ways. You have to choose. Either the wine of the dunya, which is haram, a sin, and you will be punished, or the wine of the akhirah. If I want the wine of the dunya, don't expect, even if you make it to Al-Jannah and Allah forgives your sins, the hadith says you will not have the honor of tasting the wine of Al-Jannah. So be careful, mu'mineen and mu'minat. So this is the third river in Al-Jannah. As for the fourth river in Al-Jannah, the Quran says, وَأَنْهَارٌ مِنْ عَسَلٍ مُصَفَّى. The fourth type of rivers are the rivers that you will see have honey. Beautiful, sweet, pure honey flowing, and it flows. Subhanallah, the honey of this dunya is you know, it's a little thick and it won't flow. How can you have a river? But the honey of Al-Jannah will flow in the rivers, and it's of course much, much greater than the honey of this dunya. So the Quran tells us about these rivers that exist in Al-Jannah. When we come to the ahadith also tell us about some other rivers, famous rivers in Al-Jannah. Amongst the famous rivers of Al-Jannah is Nahr al-Kawthar. Don't mix Hawd al-Kawthar and Nahr al-Kawthar. Listen carefully, brothers and sisters. We have two Kawthars on the Day of Judgment. The first is the Hawd of Kawthar. The Hawd, it's a pool, it's not a river. The Hawd of Kawthar is not in Jannah, it's beside Jannah. We drink from Al-Kawthar, and then we go to Jannah. As for the river of Kawthar, it flows inside Jannah. And some ulama say that the river of Jannah, of Kawthar, it has a source that goes into Al-Hawd. So we said the Hawd of Al-Kawthar, Tasneem, flows into it. And the river of Al-Kawthar flows into it. So anyway, the hadith of the Prophet says that Nahr al-Kawthar is the largest river in Al-Jannah. It's the largest river. And Nahr al-Kawthar, the ahadith tell us, is where the houses of the Anbiya will be. You see, in this world, if you want to buy a nice house, you go buy it on a river because you want to have a river view. The houses of the Prophets of Allah will be on Nahr al-Kawthar. And in one hadith, it's narrated from Imam al-Sadiq alayhi salam, that this river, Allah Azza wa Jal gifted it to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi. It belongs to the Holy Prophet. When did he gift it to him? When his son Ibrahim died. His son, his young baby son Ibrahim died. Rasulullah was very upset. Allah rewarded him by giving him Nahr al-Kawthar, the largest river in Al-Jannah. He gifted it to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam. And in one hadith, it's narrated by Ibn Abbas. Ibn Abbas says, when this verse was revealed, Inna a'tainaka al-kawthar. Allah says in the Quran, Inna a'tainaka al-kawthar. I have given you al-kawthar. Imam Ali alayhi salam came to Rasulullah and he asked for the tafsir of this verse. What is kawthar? What did Allah give you? Ibn Abbas says, Rasulullah told Imam Ali that Allah gave me the river of kawthar in al-jannah. And it is the largest river in Al-Jannah. So Imam Ali, he told him, Ya Rasulullah, tell me about this river. He told him, the taste is sweeter than honey. The color is whiter than milk. You will find the pebbles of this river are all gems and crystals and gold and silver. So it is something that we cannot even imagine how beautiful it is. And Allah Azza wa Jal gave it as a gift to Rasulullah. And Rasulullah told Imam Ali in the hadith, this is for me and for you and for your Shia, the Shia of Ali ibn Abi Talib alayhi salam. So this is one of the rivers of Jannah, Al-Kawthar. One hadith I read, interesting, says that one of the companions of Imam al-Sadiq came to the Imam and he told him, Sayyidi Mawlai, when I tell another person, Jazakallahu khayra, what does this mean? How many times we use this on a daily basis? When someone does a favor for me, what do I tell him? Jazakallahu khayra. May Allah reward you in the best of ways.
He asks the Imam, what is khayra? How will Allah reward me?
Listen to the answer of Al-Imam al-Sadiq.
The hadith says Al-Imam al-Sadiq said, khayra, jazakallahu khayra, huwa nahrun fil jannah. It is a river in al-Jannah. And Allah Azza wa Jal has reserved this for the Awsiya and the Shia of Ali ibn Abi Talib. Their houses will be on this river, and it stems from Al-Kawthar. So when someone, a friend, a family member tells you, does something good for you, you tell him, Jazakallahu khayra. May Allah allow you to enjoy the river of khayr. This is one of the rivers of Jannah. And finally, amongst the rivers of Jannah is the river of Rajab. You know, we have the month of Rajab. It's the seventh month of the Islamic calendar. Rajab, Sha'ban, and the Ramadan. Imam al-Kadhim alayhi salam says in one hadith that Rajab you will find in al-Jannah as well, but in the form of a river. And then the Imam says that whoever fasts one day of Rajab, mustahab. If you fast just one day of Rajab, Allah will give you the honor of tasting that river, and the taste is out of the world. So these are the rivers of Al-Jannah. Sallu ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. And then we come to the gates of Jannah. Obviously, Jannah must have gates. The hadith of Amir al-Mu'mineen alayhi salam says, إِنَّ لِلْجَنَّةِ ثَمَانِيَةَ أَبْوَابٍ. There are eight gates, doors to Jannah. Huge doors. Now, why are there eight gates to Jannah? And how do we enter these gates? The Imam himself, he mentions. He says, one door Allah leaves lil-anbiya. It's for the prophets of Allah. They will enter through one special door. Another door is for the shuhada. This is for the martyrs that die for the cause of Allah Azza wa Jal. That leaves how many? Six. He says, and five of the last six, they are for the Shia of Ali ibn Abi Talib alayhi salam. They have five gates just for themselves, the Shia of Ali ibn Abi Talib. What does this tell you indirectly? That most of the people of Jannah will be the Shia of Ali ibn Abi Talib, and that's why they will need five of the eight gates to enter heaven. And then the Imam says the last gate is for the non-Shia Muslims. Whoever was a non-Shia Muslim and he was good, he will enter Jannah, but the Imam has a condition. He says, as long as لم يكن في قلبه قطرة من بغضنا أهل البيت. As long as there is not a grain of hatred, animosity towards Ali ibn Abi Talib or Ahlul Bayt. Jannah is all about Ahlul Bayt. Everything in it belongs to them. And even if you want to enter, you have to love Ahlul Bayt alayhim as-salam. That's a condition of entering Jannah that the Holy Prophet mentioned in the Holy Quran. He said, قُلْ لَا أَسْأَلُكُمْ عَلَيْهِ أَجْرًا إِلَّا الْمَوَدَّةَ فِي الْقُرْبَى. I ask no compensation from you, no reward, he told the Muslims. I ask from you only one thing, and that is to love my family, to love Ali ibn Abi Talib, Fatima, and the rest of the Imams of their progeny. So there are eight gates that take us to Jannah. The hadith of the Prophet says, when you come to the gate of Jannah, what do you see written on the gates? The Prophet says, written on the gates of Jannah, La ilaha illallah, Muhammadur Rasulullah, Aliyun Waliyullah. Salla ala Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad. Once again, everything goes back to Ahlul Bayt alayhim wasalam. The ahadith tell us if you want to enter the gate, the guardians of Jannah will ask you for a specific passport. If you have that passport or the visa, you can enter. And that passport or visa to enter the Jannah can only be taken from Ali ibn Abi Talib alayhi salam. You have to go through Ali ibn Abi Talib to enter Jannah. Subhanallah. The Jannah is all about Ahlul Bayt. Imagine you go to a city and there is this billionaire tycoon and someone's giving you a tour and you ask him, who, you know, owns this building, this huge building? He tells you, oh, it's this billionaire. Who owns this mansion? It's this billionaire. Who owns this plaza? It's this billionaire. He owns the entire city. Everything in the city is to him. This is in the dunya. In the akhirah, in al-jannah, everything you see, you ask, who does this belong to? They'll tell you it's Ahlul Bayt alayhim as-salam. Whether it's Shajarat Tuba, whether it is Nahr al-Kawthar, whether it is the springs of al-jannah, Anything you see in Al-Jannah, the gates of Al-Jannah, you see the name of Ahlul Bayt, and it belongs to them. And finally, the ahadith tell us that the buildings, of course, there's buildings in Jannah, the buildings are made of bricks. The bricks of Jannah, the hadith says, they are either gold or silver. The dust, the sand, the soil of Al-Jannah, the hadith says, it is misk and it is za'faran, saffron, misk and saffron. And misk in this dunya is very expensive. If you want to buy a small amount, you have to pay hundreds of dollars for it. So can you imagine in Al-Jannah you find that even za'faran is so expensive. 1 kilogram of za'faran will cost you, I don't know, maybe more than $1,000, $2,000. Can you imagine in Al-Jannah it's the soil of the Jannah, the misk and the za'faran mixed. And the pebbles of Al-Jannah, the pebbles of Al-Jannah, the hadith says, they are all emeralds and rubies and gems. Subhanallah. And this is all what? This is all an understatement, like we said. The real Jannah, ما لا عين رأت ولا أذن سمعت ولا خطر على قلب بشر. Everything I'm telling you now is not the Jannah. It's only a glimpse of Jannah, because Jannah is beyond my imagination and your imagination. I'm only trying to give you an idea of what Jannah will be. Whatever I will tell you, you will go inshallah on the Day of Judgment and you will see it is much, much, much greater. So yes, like I said, Jannah revolves around Ahlul Bayt alayhim as-salam. Ali ibn Abi Talib alayhi as-salam is qaseemul jannati wal-nar. And Ali ibn Abi Talib, who is qaseemul jannati wal-nar, unfortunately in this world, he and especially Fatima, the people did not honor Ali, nor did they honor Fatima. Did the people really understand the azama, the greatness of Fatima and Ali? No. Look at what they did to Ali ibn Abi Talib alayhi salam. This is the man that owns Al-Jannah. And this is how you treat him. He was left 25 years in his house. They did not want him to be the leader. They did not want him to be the Khalifa. Only after 25 years, the last couple of years of his life, they came to him and they told him, lead us now. Ali ibn Abi Talib alayhi salam did not miss out on anything, but it was them that they miss out on the knowledge of Ali alayhi salam, on the virtues of Ali, the justice of Ali. He is the man that used to ascend the pulpit and say, saluni qabla an tafquduni. He used to go on the minbar and say, ask me, O believers, before you lose me. And on a night like this, we lost Ali ibn Abi Talib alayhi salam. On the 19th of Ramadan, like a night like this, Amir al-Mu'mineen alayhi salam, this embodiment of justice and knowledge and wisdom, was struck down in his mihrab. He used to have iftar each night in one of the houses of his sons and daughters. On a night like this, his iftar was with his daughter, Kulthum. What did Imam Ali alayhi salam have for iftar? And he was Khalifatul Muslimin. He was the ruler of the Muslim empire, the king, the emperor. So he could have had anything that he desired. But Imam Ali alayhi salam, the hadith tells us that his iftar that was given and presented to him by his daughter, Kulthum, was three things. Number one, 2 loaves of bread. And the bread of Ali wasn't the soft bread that you and I eat. Isn't there the story that one of the companions of the Imam, he went to see Imam Ali one day, and the Imam was trying to break the bread, but he couldn't because it was so stale and hard, because it was dry bread. And the companion, he was surprised. This is Ali. He cannot even break the bread. It's stale. This was Ali, the zuhud of Ali. So it was 2 loaves of bread, some salt, and some milk. This was the last supper, the last iftar of Ali before he was struck by Ibn Muljam. So she came to him and she placed the food in front of him, the milk, the bread, and the salt. Imam Ali alayhi salam, he took a step back and he told her, my dear daughter, do you not know that I do not eat 2 foods in one meal, 2 types of foods in one meal? It's like sometimes we eat fish and chicken, chicken and meat, rice, and something else. Imam Ali alayhi salam tells his daughter Kulthum, do you not know that I don't eat two types of food in one meal? And he's considering salt and milk two types. If that is the standard, then we eat 50 types of foods every night, if you want to count salt as a type of food. And he's the Khalifa of the Muslimin. Subhanallah, we have to learn from Imam Ali a little. So anyway, he tells her, oh Kulthum, please take one of them. Because I heard your grandfather Rasulullah, فَأَنِّي سَمِعْتُ جَدَّكِ رَسُولَ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَآلِهِ يَقُولُ, I heard your grandfather Rasulullah say, مَنْ طَابَ مَطْعَمُهُ وَمَشْرَبُهُ طَالَ وُقُوفُهُ بَيْنَ يَدَيِ اللَّهِ. Whoever indulges in the dunya, and you go after the dunya, then your wait on the day of judgment will be longer, because Allah is going to ask you more questions. The more you take from the dunya, the more Allah will ask you, what did you do with it? Amir al-Mu'mineen alayhi salam, he tells his daughter Kulthum, he tells his daughter Kulthum, take away one of the two foods in front of me, because I only eat one type of food. Kulthum, she wanted to lift the salt so he would have some bread and some milk. But Imam Ali alayhi salam, he told her, no, take the milk. And the last meal of Ali ibn Abi Talib alayhi salam was bread and salt. This was the last meal before he was struck, before he went on his deathbed. And only after 2 days, Imam Ali alayhi salam passed away and departed the dunya. So Imam Ali alayhi salam had his final iftar. After he finished the iftar, Imam Ali alayhi salam, he took a nap. In his dream, he saw Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi. And Rasulullah told him, Ya Ali, anta dhaifuna hadhihi al-layla. Ma ashwaqana ilayka ya Ali, inna mushtaquna ilayk. Tells him, Ya Ali, we are waiting for you here. Imam Ali wakes up. He's anxious, unsettled. He says, Inna lillah wa inna ilayhi raji'un. And then Kulthum, she says, I noticed he kept on leaving the house. He goes outside. He looks at the stars, at the sky. And he comes back. He goes, he comes back. Once he would look at the skies, he would say, Na'am hiya hiya wallah al-layla allati wa'adaniha Rasulullah. This is the night that the Prophet, he promised me, he told me so many years ago, Ya Ali, you will be killed in your mihrab. This is the night, it has come. So Kulthum, she saw her father, Imam Ali, he's very unsettled, he's anxious. My dear father, why are you so anxious and unsettled? You're such a brave man, what's wrong with you? Imam Ali told his daughter, Na'am ya bunayya. He tells her, Yes, my dear daughter, Inna abaki qad khaza al-ahwal wa qatala al-abtal wa lam yadkhul al-khawf fi qalbihi kama dakhala al-an. This is Ali, your father is the one that I fought against the greatest warriors, and I was the hero of all the battles. I was never afraid, but now I see fear in my heart. Innaha rahbatul maut. It is the fear of death. It is the rahba of death. Ali ibn Abi Talib alayhi salam knew that it wasn't too long before he would leave and depart this dunya. Then he went to take another nap. He told Kulthum, Ya Kulthum, wake me up before Salat al-Fajr, before Fajr. Kulthum, she went to wake up Ali ibn Abi Talib alayhi salam for the last time. He got up, he went, he did his wudu, he put on his clothing, and he headed towards the masjid, Masjid al-Kufa. While he went out, as he was about to leave, he reached the courtyard of the house. There was some geese, some ducks, that were gifted to Imam Hassan and Hussein. They began to yell at the face of the Imam, as if they are telling him, Ya Ali, do not leave the house tonight. Ya Ali, please stay in your house tonight, because there is imminent death or an imminent threat. Imam Ali alayhi salam, once he saw those geese, they were yelling like that, what did he say? He said, Sawa'ihun.
تتبعها نوائح. Now the animals are screaming, but in a while the people of Al-Kufa will all mourn and cry for Ali. He wanted to go out. As he opened the door, he was about to leave. His garment, he had tied his garment. It got stuck on the door, and thus his garment was untied. The Imam alayhi salam, he took his garment, he tied his garment once again, and he recited this poem. اشدد حيازيمك للموت فإن الموت يلاقيك ولا تجزع من الموت إذا حل بناديك كما أضحكك الدهر كذاك الدهر يبكيك. He speaks to himself, he tells himself, Ya Ali, your death, your destiny is very close to you, so be strong and brave, Ya Ali. Imam Ali alayhi salam goes to the masjid for the last time. He sees people, they are sleeping, he wakes them up. Amongst those individuals that were sleeping was Ibn Muljam la'natullahi alayhi. He was sleeping on his stomach. Imam Ali alayhi salam woke him up. He told him, this is the sleep of the shaitan, of the devil. And Ibn Muljam, he was hiding that poisonous sword under his clothing. He woke him up. Then Imam Ali alayhi salam came to the mihrab. He prayed a few nawafil, few mustahab salawat. Then the Imam got ready after salatus, after the adhan of salatus subuh, he got ready for the final salah. Imam Ali alayhi salam said, Allahu Akbar. The last time Imam Ali says takbiratul ihram while he is standing in the mihrab of Masjid al-Kufa. It's the last time that people have the honor of hearing the Imam say Allahu Akbar. It's the last time they have the honor they hear the Imam reciting Surah Al-Hamd. He recited the Surah and then the Imam recited the Ruku'. After the Ruku', he went into the Sujood. As he raised his head from Sujood, Ya Azzu Alaykum Ya Mu'mineen, Ya Shi'at Ali Ibn Abi Talib, Ya Azzu Alaykum. As the Imam raised his head from sujood, this enemy Ibn Muljam came running and he took out his poisonous sword and he cried out, Al-Hukmu Lillah La Laka Ya Ali. He took the sword and he struck the head of Ali ibn Abi Talib. Ayn al-Munadi wa Aliyah, Aywa Sayyida Ya, Aywa Mazluma. Imam Ali alayhi salam fell to the floor, but he made a call. Listen to the call of Ali. He called out, Fuztu wa Rabbi al-Ka'ba. I have prevailed, I have succeeded, I am triumphant by the Lord of Kaaba, by Allah. He considers this as success because he has been killed in his mihrab. No one could fight Imam Ali face to face. No one could kill Ali ibn Abi Talib face to face. And thus they killed him from behind while he was in sujood. There was chaos in the masjid. There was so much chaos and uproar in the masjid. What just happened? Who could dare strike the lion of Allah, Ali ibn Abi Talib? All of a sudden, they heard a sound from the skies. Jibreel yelling out, تهدمت والله أركان الهدى
وانفصمت العروة الوثقى قتل علي المرتضى قتل ابن عم المصطفى. He called out, the pillars of faith have been destroyed and the firm covenant of Allah has been broken because the successor and cousin of Rasulullah Ali ibn Abi Talib has been struck and has been killed. Ah, 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 ah.